Hi friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Let's have discussion for the date 22nd August 2018. Today's in our discussion we are going to deal five topics. Today's first topic is Beyond Words on Indo-Pak Ties. Recently, Pakistan's former cricketer Imran Khan won in the election and he became Prime Minister. Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi called him and congratulated him. They both spoke of shared vision of peace and development in the region. Indian High Commissioner presented cricket bat to Imran Khan with the signatures of Indian cricket players. And Imran Khan himself is a cricket player, so he wanted to resume bilateral cricket and to improve people-to-people ties. A minister in Pakistan's caretaker government came to Delhi to attend Atal Bihari Vajpayee's funeral. Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi has written a congratulatory letter to Imran Khan in which he says about constructive engagement. India is not in good terms with Pakistan since Pakistan is exporting terrorism to India. Now there is a hope that the new government in Pakistan would engage with India. There is a hope that new government formed in Pakistan would engage with India and India would engage with Pakistan so that bilateral ties would improve to the next level. Mr. Imran Khan yesterday tweeted that any differences between India and Pakistan can be resolved through dialogue. So he believes in dialogue and India had always been a supporter of dialogue. Through negotiation, we can resolve any disputes between India and Pakistan. India and Pakistan are not in good terms. There is an animosity between these two. But these gestures confirmed that both the prime ministers are at least sticking by diplomatic courtesy. From both sides, we have been witnessing there is a responsibility in their chosen words. But well-chosen words are not enough to engage with Pakistan. Both leaders face political realities. Everything seems to be good at paper, but when it comes to realities, both leaders face different problems that could inhibit them from taking any major risk. For example, Lok Sabha elections are going to be held in less than a year for Indian Prime Minister. So he may not take extreme steps to deal with Pakistan. Similarly, Mr. Imran Khan commands a thin majority. This is not enough in his parliament. And when he was campaigning for elections, he also criticized his predecessors for close ties with India. That is, he criticized those who ruled before him for taking pro-India stance. So he may choose a conservative path. What has to be done as of now? Line of control needs urgent attention and we have to restore peace and ceasefire in that region. Pakistan is already witnessing a lot of economical problems. If Mr. Imran Khan has to address that, he has to do something. What? International Financial Action Task Force demands Pakistan to end terror financing. That is, Pakistan is financing the terrorists. Terrorists are using Pakistan soil, which is disturbing the region's stability and security. If Imran Khan would do that, he would earn more goodwill by directly addressing India's concerns on the support of terrorism by Pakistan and those being pushed at the LOC. What India has to do? Indian Prime Minister has to agree to restore SAARC process by attending the long-delayed summit that has to be held in Islamabad this year. Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Pakistan Prime Minister Imran Khan have been talking in good terms and they are expressing their willingness to negotiate with each other so that peace and prosperity is prevailing in the region. So what had to be done? Preferably behind the scenes lot to be done. Let's wait and watch. Today's second topic is Supreme Court scraps nota option for Rajya Sabha polls. Supreme Court scrapped the use of nota option for Rajya Sabha polls. Why? First of all, what is nota? That is none of the above. If I do not like any of the candidates fielded by various political parties, I may go for none of the above. That is, I do not like any candidate, so I am voting for this. This particular option is meant only for universal adult suffrage and direct elections, not in the indirect elections like Rajya Sabha, according to Supreme Court. Because Rajya Sabha elections are held by the system of proportional representation by means of single transferable vote. When it comes to proportional representation, parties are given importance. Parties' ideologies are given importance. So every candidate who is supposed to vote must adhere to the instruction given by the party. Supreme Court says that the option of nota may serve in direct elections, but in the election of Council of States, that is Rajya Sabha, it would not only undermine the purity of democracy, but also serve the pattern of defection and corruption. There is a whip for every political party. During the elections of Rajya Sabha, an elector should obey the whip's order. That is, the party will guide the elector to whom to vote. So, the elector should obey and vote according to the instructions given by the party. The party discipline in this kind of election is very, very important according to the Supreme Court because it is essential for the parliamentary democracy. Nota, if allowed in indirect election, it would run counter to the discipline expected from an elector according to the 10th schedule. 10th schedule deals with anti-defection law in Indian Constitution. It will also be counterproductive to the basic grammar of law of disqualification on the ground of defection according to the 10th schedule. The use of nota cannot be sanctioned, that is, cannot be approved by way of impugned circulars, which has the effect of overriding the provisions of Article 80 subclause 4 and the provisions of Representation of People Act 1951 and the Conduct of Election Rules 1961. To put it in simple words, an executive instructions cannot override statutory provisions. Today's third topic is Supreme Court moots steps to clean up politics. This article deals with criminalization of politics that is taking place in recent time in India. The court is hearing a batch of petitions which seeks to ban persons from conducting elections if they are charged with criminal charges. Criminals are joining in a party and they are contesting elections and they become parliamentarians, state legislature, and ultimately they become ministers. This is criminalization of politics. So Supreme Court proposed that political parties have to be made accountable for this. Supreme Court could direct the Election Commission to insist that when parties get new members, they have to file an affidavit in which they have their criminal record so that they can publish and the people will know, the entire country will know how many criminals are there in the political parties. The court went on to an extent citing that Election Commission could deregister a party or withdraw its symbol if it refused to comply the measures given by the Supreme Court. The present law bars or prevents only convicted persons from fighting elections or continuing as lawmakers. That is, a person is presumed to be innocent until proven guilty in a court of law. The proposals made by the Supreme Court faced stiff opposition from the government itself. It says that the court's proposal amounted to disqualifying a prospective candidate. Attorney General Mr. Venugopal said that a political party has the right to field its own candidate. Mere charges of having committed a crime cannot be used to prevent a person from contesting election because he has the right to contest in elections. He may have done excellent work for the people and his constituency. So the people may want him to contest in elections and they may want to vote for him. And court suggestions amount to prematurely disqualifying a candidate and taking away his rights. He also said that the court is taking on itself a matter of legislature. That is, a legislature can make a law in order to deal with the issue. But the court said that it just proposed an alternative measure to deal with the issue and suggested making a political party accountable for giving membership to persons with a criminal record. The intention behind the proposals given by the Supreme Court is simple. The Supreme Court doesn't want criminals to enter into the politics. Chief Justice of India pointed out that Section 29A of the Representation of People Act requires a political party to uphold a principles of socialism, secularism, democracy, sovereignty, unity and integrity of India. If political parties allowed criminals to enter into politics, then how those parties can ensure all these principles? Today's fourth topic is International Labour Organization report flags wage inequality that is present in India. Real average daily wages in India almost doubled from 1993 to till now. That is, after economic reforms, real average daily wages have been doubled. But low pay and wage inequality remains a serious problem with respect to India. It is a big challenge to inclusive growth according to ILO and its report. The ILO has called for a stronger implementation of minimum wage laws and strengthening frameworks for collective bargaining of workers. That is, we have to ensure there is a bare minimum wage for workers and we have to empower workers and to allow them to have bargaining power. This is very much essential to deal with persistent low pay that is present in various sectors and to bridge the gaps, that is wage gaps, between rural and urban, between male and female, between regular and casual workers. The rise in average wages was more rapid in rural areas and for casual workers. This is fine. But still, these groups started at such a low base, so the wage gap is still present. 62% of the earning population belong to the category of casual workers. They earn only 143 per day. Daily wages in urban areas is twice than the rural areas, according to the International Labour Organization's report. Regional disparities in average wages have been increased over a time, with wages rising more rapidly in high wage states compared to low wage ones. One good thing about the report is the gender wage gap decreased from 48% to 34%, but still remains high if you compare with international standards. Among the all worker groups, if you see, average wages of casual rural female workers was the lowest, that is 104 per day. This report talks about lack of timely data, which is a hindrance in policy making. So we need to have a proper timely data in order to help in decision making and policy making. According to the International Labour Organization, state specific studies and comparative studies on wages are needed. This ILO also urges collaborative work between government agencies, academic institutions and expert organizations in order to have a good results. Today's fifth topic is strengthening the federal link. State Finance Commission is a unique institution created by 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment. It is to rationalize state and sub-state level fiscal relations in India. Fiscal relations meaning that financial relations. The primary task of this State Finance Commission is to rectify the growing horizontal imbalances in the delivery of essential public services to the citizens. What is this horizontal imbalances? Horizontal fiscal imbalance occurs when governments at the same level in different regions of the country have different abilities to provide services due to the different abilities of raising funds. For example, the ability of Tamil Nadu to generate revenue and the ability of the UP to generate revenue are not same. Since the ability of the revenue generation is different, the ability of the state government to provide services to the citizens are also different. The states which cannot generate more revenue cannot provide more services. So this is horizontal fiscal imbalance. So the duty of the State Finance Commission is to ensure that this imbalance is reduced. Even though State Finance Commission is playing a major important role, there is an inadequate appreciation of the significance of this State Finance Commission by the union, states as well as professional community. Article 243I of the Indian Constitution mandated that state governor has to constitute finance commission within 1 year of constitutional amendment, that is 73rd, 74th amendment, thereafter once in 5 years. This means that 5th generation state finance commission supposed to give reports by now, but only 4 states, that is Assam, Himachal Pradesh, Tamil Nadu and Kerala, have submitted their 5th state finance commission reports. Many states are yet to cross their 3rd state finance commission stage. The majority of the states have violated the mandate given by the constitution. There arises a question, is honoring the constitution is a matter of convenience? Only as per your convenience you will follow the provisions of the constitution? The question arises. The seriousness, the regularity, the acceptance of recommendations and their implementation which characterizes the union finance commissions are clearly absent when it comes to state finance commissions, even though its role is very, very important equally to Union Finance Commission. The Union Finance Commission has been widely acknowledged as professional and quasi-judicial body when compared to State Finance Commission. If you see the composition of State Finance Commission, you will see that there is an overwhelming presence of serving and retired bureaucrats rather than academics. The State Finance Commission is undoubtedly modeled on the Union Finance Commission created under Article 280 and exemplified in Articles 243I and 243Y. The Union Finance Commission is tasked with rectifying vertical imbalances and horizontal imbalances at the union and state level. The same function is being performed by State Finance Commission with reference to state level and sub-state level institutions. You will be surprised to know that the Constitution treats local government on par with state government, especially when it comes to sharing of financial resources. The task of State Finance Commission to correct horizontal imbalances is extremely important, but we are not adequately appreciating the function of State Finance Commission when compared to Union Finance Commission. So state finance commissions have to consider nearly 2.5 lakh local governments to promote minimum essential services in rural and urban areas. Cooperative federalism, which is a basic structure of Indian constitution, ensures that every citizen should be assured minimum public goods. This cooperative federalism can only be ensured when state finance commission is given due importance. Article 280 subclass 3 has been amended in order to take measures to augment the resources of panchayat and municipalities on the basis of recommendations given by the state finance commission. There is an organic link between local governments and state finance commission with respect to fiscal federalism. It is only when interstate disparities are reduced by the Union Finance Commission through their recommendations and the implementation, then only intrastate disparities can be reduced by State Finance Commission through horizontal distribution criteria. If the functions of Union Finance Commission and the functions of State Finance Commissions are performed properly and simultaneously, then only we can ensure that Indian Federation becomes sustainable and inclusive nation state. Union Finance Commission do not have a data problem in reviewing the finances of Union and states. That is, Union Finance Commission having enough data, having timely data to deal with the issues involving Union and states. When it comes to State Finance Commission, it is lacking the data. Even if they have a data, they are not a reliable one. Unlike the Union Finance Commission, no State Finance Commission can ignore Article 243G and Article 243W. Because they speak of planning for economic development and social justice, which is very much important for a welfare state. And Article 243 ZD, which mandates that every state must constitute a district planning committee for special planning and environmental conservation at the sub-state level. While Union Finance Commission making report, it has to study the reports given by state finance commissions of various states so that it can give a clear picture. But no Union Finance Commission has done the homework in reading and analyzing state finance reports. Meaning that Union Finance Commissions have failed to play a handholding role in placing decentralized governance properly in cooperative federal map of India. Union Finance Commission has to give consolidated account of the reality at the sub-state level, or they have to highlight which report went wrong, where it went wrong, how it went wrong. If Union Finance Commission have failed in this task, they cannot legitimately guide states or contribute to improve the goals of constitutional amendments. So State Finance Commission have not been provided with the necessary environment to play their rightful role in Indian fiscal federalism. A great opportunity to build a regional equity in India has been undermined. So what can be done? State Finance Commissions have to be given due importance, and the reports given by State Finance Commissions have to be read by Union Finance Commission while making its own recommendations. And there should be cooperation between State Finance Commissions and Union Finance Commissions while making reports, so that we get a holistic picture about India, so fiscal cooperation can be ensured and we can assure that the basic services are given to our own citizens. Thank you.